Okay, now here he is. Jacques Vallee began his professional life as an astronomer at the Paris Observatory in 1961. While on the staff of the French Space Committee, he witnessed the destruction of tracking tapes of unknown objects orbiting the Earth, initiating a lifelong interest in the UFO phenomenon. Vallee arrived in the United States in 62, worked in the astronomy department at the University of Texas at Austin, and wrote two highly respected scientific examinations arguing for the extraterrestrial hypothesis, then of UFO origins. In 1967, he received a PhD in computer science from Northwestern University, became a very close associate of the late Dr. J. Allen Hynek, then the scientific consultant for the U.S. Air Force on Project Blue Book. If you remember the movie Close Encounters of the Third Kind, the person who was the Frenchman in the movie, of course, depicted Dr. Jacques Vallee, and he is our guest for the next couple hours on Coast to Coast, and he's back. Hey, Jacques, how are you?
I'm very good. How are you?
Oh, always good to have you here on the program, my friend. Life is well. Life is well. I was just in Austin, Texas, a few weeks ago, by the way. It's a great city, Jacques.
It's changed quite a bit since 1962.
Oh, my gosh. And it sure has. I fell in a hole when I was out there, and nobody came to come and pull me out of it. And I was splashed looking like Swamp Man. I looked like an extraterrestrial myself that day, Jacques. Now, you have been doing some tremendous work over the years in the UFO field, and you know, you've stopped, slowed down for a while, and you're coming back with a pretty good vengeance, which I like. People are beginning to notice you again. What's the reason for that?
Well, you know, Dr. Hynek used to quote the Chinese proverb: "There is a time to fish, and there is a time to mend your nets." And in science, you know, you go through phases of having a lot of data, being in the middle of a field that's very active, where you just don't have too much time to think and analyze. You're just too busy collecting data. And then, in quiet periods, you can go back to the lab and, you know, close the door and try to make sense out of the patterns that emerge. And so that's what I try to do. I'm not chasing ambulances. I'm not especially interested in having another, you know, 100 or 1,000 reports. I'm really trying to, my contribution, if there is one, is going to be to try to come up with a methodology to look for patterns in all this.
And what I find fascinating, Jacques, because I've looked into the UFO issue for many years myself now, is that you're coming back in a bigger way at a moment where I think we who have been in this field for a long time need someone like you. I don't think I recall a time where more and more UFO reports have been coming, and they look so credible, they look so important, and I'm just glad that you're coming back into the field again.
Well, I never had any delusions about solving the problem, you know, by myself or with a small group. I've always thought that I had a responsibility because I've been in a position to receive valuable reports from people, from, you know, through my writing and through the places where I've worked and my association with the privilege of being associated with people like Allen Hynek and others. And my responsibility is to try to transmit this and to try to help people who come, you know, after us sort out the good data and not have to waste as much time as we've wasted trying to sift through all the irrelevant stuff, because, you know, 90% of all the data is explainable for all the usual reasons. And so we have to concentrate on the unexplainable, on the really puzzling data.
Sure. And then that 10% is very important. Just over the past several years now, we've seen some incredible cases, some incredible unexplained cases. You know, the episode at O'Hare Airport.
Yes.
That was one I want to talk with you about, the Stephenville, Texas sighting that just occurred as well. But is it my impression, do you feel the same way, that we are getting some very credible UFO reports lately?
Yes, we're getting fewer reports, Possibly because the media if you take all the numbers, of course, on the internet, you've got thousands of things all the time. But that's really at the noise level. In terms of the well-documented reports, the media seems to be less interested these days in the subject. To their credit, they are distracted by other things, sure, like the elections. And the few cases that are being studied are very, very interesting indeed. And as you may know, the O'Hare sighting was analyzed by a group of scientists around Dr. Haynes, the NARCAP group that is doing a tremendous job of documenting aerial cases, and those have become a class by themselves. The cases that over the years have been seen by pilots and airline officials and control tower operators, radar operators, because here you have usually instrumented data and you have trained observers.
Well, and the FAA comes out and talks about weather patterns and things like that at O'Hare, yet when you look at some of the pictures we've seen of clouds with donut holes punctured through them, and then the testimony of so many people, you begin to shake your head and you begin to wonder, how can they come up with excuses like that?
Well, the first tendency is to try to explain it away in part, so they don't have to talk to journalists, and they don't have to talk to the media, and they can go back to their normal life. And it's a human tendency, especially since there is no rule or no regulation that says that those have to be reported anymore. Of course, in other times, a case like the one at O'Hare would have created a great deal of interest, both from the military and from the public. But the public seems to be pretty jaded these days, and that this thing could sit there for probably about 10 minutes, from what I've heard, right over Concorde C at O'Hare Airport in the late afternoon, and very, very few people have really asked the right questions about it.
In Britain, not too long ago, pilots witnessed seeing a huge objects. One pilot quoted as saying, I don't know what it is. I don't know if it's extraterrestrial, but I'll tell you this, I've never seen anything like this before. And we're getting more and more of this, like the Stephenville, Texas sighting, of course, too. So many witnesses seeing this huge 3-football field long object again. Is it possible with all these recent sightings, Jacques, that we might be looking at the same object or the same craft, whatever it might be?
It seems to be, there was a time, in the 70s and 80s when we, being the ufology community, the people who were trying to make some sense out of all this, thought that there were clear patterns of objects in terms of size and shape.
Mm-hmm.
And so on. That seems to have broken down, and my colleagues may disagree with me on that, but we have more and more reports of large triangles, more and more reports of very, very large objects like the one that you mentioned over England. Actually, it wasn't over England, it was over the channel between England and France. So the English are saying, they are telling the French, why don't you investigate it? It's not one of ours. And the French are saying, maybe it's English, that's usual, bureaucratic behavior. But we seem to have a wide variety of shapes and patterns of objects.
Do you believe that the United States or some government on this planet is capable of building and keeping it secret, an object, a craft that big, and getting it up there and letting it travel at these apparent speeds?
As you know, professionally, I follow technology. Mm-hmm. My business is really...
As a venture capitalist.
Yeah. Investing in high technology, usually as the first money. So we see a lot of very creative, ambitious new things. Today, technology can do amazing things, and there are things flying. If you look at how many countries are building drones, for example, that go from the size of a flea to the size of a fairly sizable aircraft. And some of them have extraordinary shapes. So, yes, something could be built and probably is being built that people are reporting in good faith as a UFO. That does not explain the phenomenon going back 50 years or more, and it certainly does not explain the speeds. I mean, you still have to follow the usual rules of aerodynamics if you're going to build something like this. To my knowledge, those rules have not, those laws of physics have not been repealed yet. So UFOs, the unexplained cases that people are reporting, have to do with something else. Also, if we had that technology, then, why are we still flying B-52s, over Afghanistan?
Exactly. Let's talk a little bit about this Stephenville, Texas sighting. Have you had an opportunity to look into this one, Jacques?
I have not. I'm concentrating on just a few cases at a time, and I like to go back and work on old cases. I know a number of people have looked at the Stephenville case, and I have not done a special study of it.
When you put together the Alien Contact trilogy in the second volume, Confrontations, you looked at some incredible UFO cases. Was there one that really stood out for you?
There is a series of cases in Brazil that still, that's the one thing that I come back to again and again and again. My wife and I had we went to Brazil 3 times to meet with people there and to study cases there fairly quietly. But the third time we were in the area around Belém, between Belém and Manaus, at the mouth of the Amazon, and in 1977 there was a wave of sightings in that whole region, and it's not the jungle there. It's not what you imagine the Amazon to be in the deep jungle. It's more it's a very rural area, but you can walk through it, and there are farms and ranches and so on. And there are a number of islands in the Amazon River itself. Over a period of 3 years, in the fall of 77, there were observations every day, every night, actually, of objects, some small objects, some large objects, dropping from the sky, some coming out of the water, and flying at low level over the villages there and over the beaches. The people were terrified. They were terrified in part because these objects had beams that seemed to cause harm to the people who were hit by those beams. So all the people who could leave those islands, the island of Mosquero and the island of Colares especially, went back to the mainland. They went back to Belém, which is a large city on the south shore of the Amazon. And very few people were left there. The people who were left there included a medical doctor that we spoke to, and included some of the witnesses. They saw the objects, but they also photographed them, and they also saw a team of Air Force intelligence, about 60 people, who came and camped on those beaches, and they had cameras, they had film cameras, and they started observing those things night after night after night. Now, here we have the witnesses, and you have the ideal situation.
Sure.
You have a wave of unexplained cases, and the witnesses are 60 intelligence officers from the Brazilian Air Force. I had a chance to spend a day with the man who was the head of that task force. And this was, of course, over 10 years later. And actually, the Brazilians who were with us were amazed that we were invited inside the Air Force base and spent a day with this man and his staff. But they went over what they had seen. There were three levels of reports they had written. They only shared the first level, which was confidential, but was something that they could share. The other two were classified, and they could not share them. In fact, they didn't have access to them anymore. And those cases, these men were not kidding. I mean, they were still talking about it as something that was very, very powerful, somewhat terrifying, and completely unexplained.
An incredible effect on them, no doubt.
Yes. Now, these are intelligence officers. The man who was head of that task force was from the Amazon basin. His mother was of Indian descent. He spoke the languages of the Amazon, Indians. The area that they covered was called Primero Comar, and that's an area the size of, slightly larger than Texas. And they know those areas very well. They know the local population very well, and they obviously know everything that flies.
Yet it continues to happen time and time again. Stay with us. Dr. Jacques Vallee, our guest for the next hour and a half. I'm George Norrie, and this, of course, is Coast to Coast AM. We'll be right back. With our special guest, we've got two tonight in our floating format, Jacques Vallee. And we'll be back with Jacques in just a moment on Coast to Coast AM. Jacques, I never had an opportunity to talk with you about the 1947 Roswell case. Did you ever look into that, and what's your take on that?
You're posing this as a very innocuous and innocent question. You know, you're opening, a very large area. I have followed. I have a lot of respect for Mr. Friedman, for Stanton Friedman. Mm-hmm. I followed his research, and I respect it. He's one of the people in the field who actually, do their homework and do it carefully. I've read the testimonies that have been assembled. I think most people don't realize that for many, many years, Roswell was just not mentioned in the context of UFO research.
Right.
It's really in the 80s that it became an item of interest for people. Before then, there were lots of cases in 1947 that were more interesting to people, and there were all these rumors about crashed things, but you could never pin them down. You could never really, the witnesses never wanted to be mentioned, and so on. Roswell then emerged, and there was suddenly a lot of publicity about it, and it became a cause célèbre, if you allow me to slip into French. I have a problem with making Roswell such a prominent case, because then the whole in the discussion between about the phenomenon with skeptics,
right.
The skeptics will say, well, guys, give us one case. I mean, you have too many cases. Give us your best case, and we'll investigate it. And then the ufologists say, well, Roswell. And but in Roswell, we actually have nothing that a scientist can take back into his lab. We have testimony from apparently honest, people who are remembering something that happened many years
right.
ago. The testimony, when you look at the different books and the different studies, is very confusing and contradictory. The description of what, and again, there is no question that something fell from the sky in Roswell. There is no question something fell from the sky. There is no question that, item number two, fact number two, the army or the military came in and picked up every piece of it, and then they lied about what it was. I mean, those are three facts. So on the basis of that, it's tempting to jump to the conclusion that, well, this must have been a UFO. Okay. Well, it could have been, or it could have been something else. And when you put it in the context of everything else that was going on in the Roswell area at the time, remember, this was the only base in the world that had atom bombs. This was also an area where a lot of research was going on, including medical research that has never really been documented very well, some of which remains classified, including medical research which, as several authors have pointed out, may have violated some of the standards of human subject research. There could have been a lot of reasons for throwing a veil of secrecy over what was actually going on there. The explanations that have been given are not very convincing. You know, the Air Force has said, well, it was a balloon. Actually, what's being described, it looks like a balloon. Mm-hmm. It looks like a reflecting surface of some kind, some advanced material, but not advanced by our standards, certainly interesting material by the standards of 1947, but something that looked like was very light material, like balsa wood with hieroglyphics on it. Well, many people have pointed out there were such things used to as the armature of balloons that were classified at the time, that were designed to pick up different, radiation levels in the higher atmosphere and so on, that were classified. So there is a mix of puzzling facts and explanations that are not complete explanations. And you end up with something where the, you know, a scientist with an open mind is going to say, look, you're not giving me anything that I can really work on. There are so many other UFO cases where we have data, where we have maybe not hardware in the kind of hardware we would like to have, but we certainly have metal that has been left behind in connection with reliable descriptions by witnesses that we can interview today. And as you know, I mean, in Confrontations, in the second book of the trilogy, I have an entire chapter on looking for patterns in that material, some of which I own. So, there is material, there is metal residue that is puzzling. It's not something that would be unexplainable in terms of Earth chemistry, but it's very, very strange.
Would it have been difficult to explain in terms of Earth chemistry based on the fact that it was 1947?
No.
It would not? Okay.
No.
Okay. You know, one of the things, though, Jacques, that astounds me about Roswell is this deathbed signed affidavit by Lieutenant Walter Haut, who originally put out the news release that the Army Air Force had found this wreckage and had it, and then he changed the story. He said he was told to change it. But when he died, he left this document that claims that he saw the crashed wreckage. And I find that to be pretty compelling. Of everything that I've heard about Roswell, the Walter Haut deathbed confession seems to be pretty fascinating to me.
It's all fascinating. I've spent time with Colonel Corso. I've spent time with other people who had been hired to investigate events around Roswell. It is fascinating, but it is not the best case on which to base an argument about the reality of UFOs.
With Alien Contact Trilogy, in the three books, Dimensions, Confrontations, and Revelations, Revelations seem to have changed. It went from the first two where they went from cases and historical records to this one seemed to be darker, that there seemed to be some kind of danger involved in this field. Now, that's my impression. You wrote it.
Your impression is correct. Actually, I stopped the writing twice. I gave up on the book twice because I was somewhat repelled by the material. And the material had to do, well, the first volume is Dimensions, and it's really an overview of the history of the phenomenon, putting it in historical perspective and bringing it to the present. Confrontations is really the most important book from my point of view. People always say, why don't scientists go into the field and investigate those things?
Right.
Well, that's what we did, okay? My wife and I and a small team of friends and colleagues. And Confrontations is really the summary of about 10 years of research. Most of, practically all the cases are first-hand cases investigated at the site. It's not armchair research. You know, we went there, we found the witnesses, we spoke to them, and we inspected the site. And we, in many cases, we analyzed what was there. Then I couldn't leave it there because the story is bigger than that.
Right,
the story includes belief systems, it includes cults, it includes contactees, it includes people with extreme beliefs who have contributed to creating what the public thinks of today as the UFO phenomenon. You know, that includes, for example, the HIM group that became Heaven's Gate. In a prior book in 1975, mm-hmm. I had, actually 79, called Messengers of Deception, I had warned people about not joining those groups. I attended a meeting of that group, and I mention it again in Revelations, a meeting of that group at Stanford, where one of the students who listened to the presentation by those by the members of the cult asked what's the risk in joining you, and the answer was you only risk your life.
Yeah, exactly.
And that people don't want to hear that. The book was at the time was, and that warning was rejected by most of the UFO believers or researchers, and something that was irrelevant, you know. So these are, you know, crazy people with their own little crazy belief, and that's not relevant to what we do. Well, it is relevant because it's shaping our perceptions of it, and of course we've seen that later in the mass suicide of the members of Heaven's Gate. It's important to study those groups, and I'm not a sociologist, so I can only go so far in calling attention to that aspect of the problem. And then you have another panel, so to speak, that's even more confusing, which is the intervention of intelligence services. And when you spend a lot of time in the field talking to witnesses about what they've seen, after a while you become aware that there is more than just natural phenomena and things that could be UFOs, but there are also people playing games. Now, some of those games may be played, maybe psychological warfare exercises. There may be very legitimate from the point of view of the military or the training of special forces. And but to give you an example, because people are going to say, well, it's all speculation.
Mm-hmm,
well,
sure.
Let me tell you something that's not speculation. I have a friend, actually, a colleague in venture capital, who used to be in the special forces. And one of the things that they did, and this was back in the 70s and 80s, was to attempt penetration of nuclear sites, American nuclear sites. They would drop from the sky at night with out of devices that were made to look like flying saucers. Now, if you're a guard at a missile base and you're told to shoot at any helicopter that comes over the fence, if a helicopter comes over the fence, you're going to shoot at it. If a flying saucer comes over the fence, or the Virgin Mary comes over the fence, what do you do with your machine gun? And there are exercises like that.
Right.
That may explain why there are strange things seen around missile sites or nuclear sites. attempting penetration, you know, for the sake of security of those sites is very important. And people do some pretty weird things. And to some extent, when you really look into it and you talk to people like that, you begin to see that some of that is legitimate. But it's very confusing. And it's going to be very confusing to somebody who just happens to be there and watch this and not know what's going on. So I thought I had to document some of those cases, and some of the prominent UFO cases of the 70s and 80s and 90s, in my opinion, are just such exercises.
Dr. David Jacobs believes also that there's a dark side to the ufology field, that whatever this mission is, of whatever these may be, he believes that it's not on friendly terms here. Do you somewhat agree with that?
Well, I've discussed it with Dr. Jacobs. And we may have come to similar feelings from different directions.
Right.
My feeling about the fact that those things are not necessarily friendly, you know, assuming there is a form of consciousness associated with it, comes from what happened in Brazil, for example, where definitely there was hostile behavior. It was hostile behavior, but it wasn't. Those things were not really displayed as weapons. I mean, they could have, they could have done much more harm if what we think about the technology is correct. At the same time, what Dr. Jacobs and Bud Hopkins have done is derived from hypnosis of abduction victims.
Right.
And as you may know, I have a big problem with hypnosis. I don't think hypnosis is the right way to analyze those cases.
Yeah, you don't believe it extracts the right information.
Well, I'm no expert in that, but I read what experts have written, and I've consulted with a number of psychiatrists and psychologists, clinical psychologists, and people who teach hypnosis to clinical psychologists. They all tell me the same thing, that if you are in front of a person who believes that they've had an experience which is so traumatic, the last thing you should do is use hypnosis. There are other ways of extracting information that are much more gentle and more reliable. Furthermore, hypnosis, has been looked at as a method for extracting the truth in court. And there is a very large literature about the excesses, you know, and the mistakes made with hypnosis, especially in the hands of untrained people. And so I don't think we can rely on that material.
Jacques, we know something is happening. What we don't know is who and why and where necessarily. But there's so many different theories, that they're time travelers from our own planet, that they might be dimensional, that they're truly extraterrestrial from other planetary systems. Have you come to any specific conclusions as to what you think is going on?
No, I really haven't, and I think we shouldn't try to come up with conclusions at this point. You know, it's true that it's very confusing, and there is all that data, but we have a way of addressing that, and it's called science, and the science has never been done.
No, it hasn't caught up with us at all.
People like, Dr. James McDonald, Dr. Hynek, and myself, and Dr. Haynes, and a number of other people, Dr. Poher in France, and so on, have studied this with our training as scientists, but that's, we haven't done science. I mean, that's not the way you do science. The way you do science is you fund a number of teams in competition with each other. You go for proposals for research with a particular goal, usually a limited goal. You don't try to solve the whole problem at once. You try to go for chunks of it. You develop databases that are reliable, and then you do that step by step. And that's how, you know, that's how the internet was built. That's how cancer research is done. That's how science progresses. It has never been done. So how can we even hazard hypotheses? I mean, sure, we can speculate, you know, certainly in science fiction, which is something I love, we've got lots of ideas on what those things could be, but that we have no way of backing up any of that. So it becomes a battle of beliefs.
Jacques, we're at the top of the hour. We've got one more hour to go with you, and one of the things we'll do is open up the phone lines. And we're with Dr. Jacques Vallee. If you've been following the UFO field for a long, long time, well, you know who he is. And if you're brand new to it, well, you'll find out in just a moment. This is our floating format night, so this will be Dr. Vallee's last hour with us. We'll take your phone calls next hour, 2 hours with Stephen Bassett, as we talk about the push to get through the truth on Coast to Coast AM. Jacques, the Billy Meyer case perplexes me, the one from Switzerland, of course. I mean, some of his pictures from years gone past, absolutely staggering. Now that we're into the computer age and Photoshop, you know, you wonder a little bit, but it is just an incredible story. Have you ever looked at that or your thoughts on that case?
I have, and I've traveled there, and I've met some of the people in the group on the property. And the pictures are stunning. The question is, what are they pictures of?
Yeah.
And are they pictures of a model? I believe they are pictures of a model. Mm. And what astonishes me is the willingness to believe on the basis of just a few pictures. The people have been swayed by the beauty and the precision of those pictures,
mm-hmm.
And there are some films also. And I had, as you probably know, in San Francisco is not Hollywood, but there is a community of cinema, you know, avant-garde artists and movie makers and so on.
True.
Here in San Francisco.
Truly,
as well.
Truly professionals.
And they get together from time to time to look at each other's movies and to look at interesting things. And one evening, those are experts who make their own movies. And there was a series of films about UFOs, including the Billy Meyer movies. And it was very interesting because you would see... it was a movie that Billy Meyer had shot in which the ship vanished on the spot. So you could see the saucer hovering over the landscape, over the field, over the grass and so on, and then all of a sudden it would be gone. Well, what apparently he didn't know, and that I would not have noticed it, but the people in the room did notice it, and they rewound the film and they showed me that When you stop the video camera and you restart it to do a special effect, as in making the flying saucer disappear, it leaves one blank frame. And that one blank frame, when your eye is trained, you can clearly see it. You can also see that the grass was moving from left to right when the saucer was there, and then it was moving from right to left when the saucer wasn't there. So that really gives you, that forces you to raise the question as to whether somebody didn't just stop the camera, remove the model, and start shooting again. And, those things are easy to do. And unfortunately, there are too many fakes and too many hoaxes in this business, especially in the more modern cases, and especially now that the internet is around.
Oh my, yeah.
It creates a market for that. What the lesson from, and I can't prove that, and I'm not accusing anybody of anything, but those are my suspicions.
Okay, let's take some phone calls and continue chatting with you this hour, Jack. And by the way, what's the future hold for you? What's next for you?
I continue to be very interested in this because it's my business. I mean, my business is to try to understand what technology can do, what science can do, and I really think the UFO phenomenon is an opportunity to do some good science. Again, I don't have the answer, but mainstream physics today is speculating about the nature of time, about the possibility of multiple universes, of parallel universes. And when I listen to what the UFO witnesses are telling me, they're not describing spacecraft. They are describing something that could, you know, literally come out of nowhere and disappear into nowhere. They're describing things that, for example, in one case that I'm studying carefully now, several witnesses, including policemen, were within a few meters, this was in France, of an object that came down as a light. That light came over a field. Out of that light, the only way I can say is that a craft precipitated out of it. That craft was apparently metallic. It made deep imprints in the field. And then after a few minutes, it rose again, went back into the light, and the light vanished on the spot. Well, this is not any kind of a spacecraft that, you know, that NASA is going to build, or Boeing or Lockheed today. Okay, this is weird stuff, and it's stuff that is very, very interesting. And here, again, the witnesses are absolutely unimpeachable. I've spoken to them several times. I've been to the site. We have imprints of the traces. This was a physical object. It was not a physical object all the time, and that is what really interests me. I mean, this is where I would love to enlist the help of, you know, of a team of scientists to look at those cases.
So you can say then, beyond a shadow of a doubt, that whatever is happening, it's truly extraordinary.
Yes, and it's physical.
My gosh. Let's go east of the Rockies. Chris, you're on Coast to Coast. Where are you calling from?
Good evening, George. Yes, I'm calling from Long Island, New York.
Great.
Listening to you on WABC.
Thanks,
AM.
Chris. Sure thing.
Dr. Vallee.
Yes, sir.
Good evening, sir. There was a book of yours that I was really fond of, The Invisible College, and in your conclusion to that book, you suggested that what we were seeing in the UFO phenomena was a control system and a reinforcement system that was conditioning human consciousness, and you went as far as to suggest that it was shifting the human learning curve toward a new cosmic behavior. Do you still subscribe to that view?
Well, that view is derived from analyzing the pattern of cases over the years and over several decades. It behaves as a schedule of reinforcement, you know, as a learning system, essentially, and as a control system. Now, that doesn't mean that it is controlling us. It could be that we're controlling ourselves, or it may be that that's just the way the mechanism works. You know, just like in ecology, if you will, you know, you could say, you know, Mother Earth is punishing us by having volcano eruptions and tornadoes, but you could also say that it's a natural mechanism that's creating those things, and that there is no consciousness having actually the intent to do this. And it's the same thing with this phenomenon. I think the question is very much open. So in answer to your question, yes, I still believe that it's behaving, that the best way to analyze it over the years is as a pattern of waves that resembles a control system, and that we are adapting to that control system. And that's the interesting question then is, can that be tested? And I was proposing this as one of the as a hypothesis that could be scientifically tested. There must be ways of finding out, when you're inside a control system, finding out whether it's open or closed.
The late Dr. J. Allen Hynek, at this point, if he were alive today, I know you respected him greatly, Jacques. What would he be saying about what we know today? Would his views have changed at all over the years?
Dr. Hynek was a man with many many levels. He confessed to me that the reason he got into science was not for the power and the glory of science, but to find the limitations of science. He was very much, at one level, he was very much a mystic. We found out that, you know, when we would get together, We would talk about UFOs for a while, but then eventually we would talk about the history of science, the history of esoteric philosophy and natural philosophy, and so on. And what are the limits of science in terms of parapsychology? He was very much interested in the remote viewing experiments. He was very much interested in all of that. So he would not be surprised by what has been learned, you know, since in the 20 years since he died. I can't tell you what he would be. He was a very creative man. I can't tell you what his ideas would be now, but I think he would have moved on to increasingly philosophical view of this whole thing, because he certainly, you know, I've only been doing this for 50 years. He did it for many more years. He was there in 1947 at the very beginning.
Yes, that's true. Wildcard Line, you're on the air with us. Where are you calling from?
Hi, I'm calling from Toronto.
Okay, go ahead.
Hello, Jacques. I got to hear you talk at the last IRVA conference, and I've also met with Ingo Swann.
Yes?
He tells me that zero-point energy has been reverse-engineered at SRI in the 1970s from his alien contacts. He also can see the future quite well and did not miss 9/11. The information that comes out of remote viewing forewarns of future disasters. So why was 9/11 not prevented?
Well,
that's a tough one.
I have followed, of course, some of the research that, you know, a number of people have been doing about zero point energy. That goes back many, many years. It goes back from pure physics, without any reference to UFOs necessarily or to remote viewing. Physicists have been speculating about zero-point energy theories for many years. To my knowledge, it has not been demonstrated. The theories seem to be getting better and better. I'm not an expert in that area of physics. I certainly hope, given the fact that we're running out of energy on the Earth, I certainly hope that somebody is going to come up with a way to harness it. I mean, we should explain what zero point energy is. There is, of course, electromagnetic frequencies throughout the universe, and you can put a similarity or a metaphor of a pendulum. You know, when the pendulum stops swinging, it still has a tiny little movement around the zero point of rest. Well, that's what, there is a similar thing for electromagnetic energy, and that zero point of rest represents a tremendous amount of energy when the current theories about electromagnetic radiation predicts that an enormous amount of energy would be stored in certainly if you could tap the energy of the universe. However, the question is, how can you extract it, and how do you put numbers behind the coefficients, the parameters in the theory, and is that really something that it's ever going to be practical, or is it just a theoretical curiosity? I certainly hope that somebody has a breakthrough about that. There is a book called The Road to Zero Point that summarizes all that research. That's a very good book. On 9/11, I did not know that Ingo had remote viewed and predicted 9/11. So I can't comment on that.
I was not aware of that either. Okay, let's go to our West of the Rockies line. Jonathan, you're on Coast to Coast. Hi there.
Hello, how you doing? Well, Jonathan from Los Angeles. Hello, okay, George and Dr. Vallee. I would like to ask Dr. Vallee if he's familiar with the mysterious lights on the moon. And also, is that a plausible explanation? And if so, what is his hypothesis? And I'll take the answer off the air. Thank you very much.
Yes, sir. Well, lights have been noticed on the moon for many, many years. Of course, going back to the 18th and 19th century, as soon as people had telescopes that were good enough. The number of observers, both amateurs and professionals, spent many, many nights watching the moon, mapping the moon, which is a fairly easy thing to do. And they noticed strange lights. There is no question that, and those were usually flashes of light, or they were linear patterns of light, or they were just glowing spots. And there is no question that happened. Now, there are a number of explanations. Of course, some people speculated that there were people on the moon signaling to us, but there are better explanations because those things always happen under the same conditions. And so some of the possible explanations are, number one, that meteorites hit the moon, and the moon doesn't have an atmosphere or a very, very tiny, atmosphere. But when there is an impact, it could create a flash of light, and you would see it. The sun can reflect on rocks that have, you know, a particular structure to create a flash of light as well. And there may also be gases from the moon itself that would be glowing, just as we do have that kind of phenomenon on Earth. So I'm not saying that swamp gas, I don't think there are swamps on the moon, but there could be chemical processes that could give rise to those lights. To my knowledge, and I know there are probably people listening to me who are disagreeing with that, but to my knowledge, there is nothing that has been unexplained in terms of repeated lights from the moon.
What about angels, demons? What about those possibilities?
When you look at, you know, in one of the studies I've done, I've compared the UFO phenomenon to folklore. And just as if you were a farmer in the 15th century and you saw a strange light in your field and you saw little creatures dancing around the light, and you told that, when you got back to the village, you probably would be accused of sorcery or witchcraft,
right,
or of congress with the devil. And the church was suppressing those stories. And today, if you're a farmer and you see a light in your field and you see little aliens dancing around the light, science is going to tell you that you probably had an hallucination, or that you saw the moon rising. And it's the same phenomenon in sociological terms. So, and the behavior of the beings is pretty much the same. So I think you could draw a parallel, and we have an opportunity to study folklore in the making, in a way, because to the extent that those stories are repressed, they reemerge in, like fairy tales. I think were probably based in part on real observations of about the same thing that people are observing now.
Stay with us, Jacques. We'll be back. We'll take final phone calls with you in just a moment on Coast to Coast AM. Next hour, Stephen Bassett joins us, our floating format tonight. We'll be right back, though. We'll take final phone calls with Dr. Jacques Vallee on Coast to Coast AM. Jacques, did you ever look at the Rendlesham case out there in Britain?
Yes, I did. And I mention it in one of the books in Revelations. I'm very puzzled by it. Everybody has been puzzled by it, but
sure.
from a different angle, I'm wondering whether it is a psychological warfare exercise. There are a number of things, and of course that has been denied loudly by the U.S. Air Force. If you remember, it's an English air base, but with an American facility on the same on the same land.
Right.
And there were a number of incidents there with a light that was at ground level in a wood that was seen. There is no question there was a light there. There was an object that was luminous. And there were a number of Air Force, both American and English personnel, who saw it. But they were they were asked to not have any weapons and go there and watch it from a distance, and they were then interviewed very carefully afterwards. There are hints that there were people there who knew that that light was going to be there and that it arrived over the water, over the North Sea. That is the kind of situation that you would set up if you were testing, if you wanted to expose a number of people, a calibrated cohort of subjects to an unknown, to a stimulus that would be unknown to them, and gauge their reaction in a military context. So that is just too similar to other psychological warfare exercises for me to jump to the conclusion that it was a UFO.
Okay, back to the phones we go. Let's go east of the Rockies. You're on with Jacques Vallee on Coast to Coast. Hi there.
Good morning, George.
Hey.
Good morning, Mr. Vallee.
Good morning.
I'm fascinated by the incident in South America, and I understand that the intelligence commander committed suicide.
Yes.
And there were photos taken.
Colonel Holanda Lima.
I was wondering if the government gave you access to those photos. And I know you were interrupted by the break. And if you could go into a little more detail. And thank you very much, sir.
There is a part of the story that I have not written about. After we were briefed by the colonel about what they saw, and we spent about an hour looking at the report, and the report was day by day, hour by hour, minute by minute description of trajectories of objects and descriptions of objects that came out of the Amazon and objects that flew that dropped from the sky, and we also, as I mentioned, interviewed a doctor who had treated about 40 people who had very peculiar symptoms after being exposed to the light of those objects. Well, after that, some of the military people took us aside, invited us to their home, and they were obviously extremely frustrated by the whole situation and the way they had been treated and the way the reports had been essentially covered up. And they had preserved, even though they no longer had access to those reports, they had preserved some of the pictures they had taken. And these people were serious. For example, they had, one of the things they had done is they had changed the pattern for the airlines over the entire area of the mouth of the Amazon, so that they changed the landing patterns for Belen and the approach pattern for Belen and Manaus for a period of 3 months. So there was nothing flying over that area. There were no aircraft, no balloons, no human craft flying over that area. So if there was something in the sky, it was a UFO. And they took pictures. And we had a chance to see some of those pictures. They included objects that were flying at night over the canopy and illuminating the canopy of the forest and underneath. There was no question that this had been real. Now, if you go to Brazil now and you go to the major cities and the major universities and you ask doctors and you ask military people whether this happened, they'll say, oh, yeah, you know, those folks in the fields and in those peasants, they see all kinds of things, and they relate it to, you know, their spiritual beliefs in spirits and so on, and don't pay attention to that. Well, that's a reaction of, you know, big city folks, big city scientists, who've never taken the trouble to go there. When you go there and you speak to the people who were there in 1977, and again, these were Air Force intelligence officers, and you spend a couple of days with them, you get it, that this was very real. We also spoke to fishermen. It was very simple. We went to the beach, and you have the boats are there on the sand, and the fishermen are working with their nets. And we went up to them, and we said, "Do you guys remember what happened around here in 77? And they said, "Oh, yes, we do," because we couldn't fish anymore. You know, they fish at night. For one thing, it's very, very hot, as you may imagine, you know, in the basin of the Amazon during the day. They fish at night. They could not go out at night. And they one of the reasons the population went back to the mainland is that they were starving. So something happened there. It was very big, and the whole story is still, you know, to a large extent unknown.
What's so fascinating, Jacques, is no matter what conclusions we draw from any of these, it's truly outstanding whatever is going on. Now, if we had to, I think of a reason, not necessarily who or where, but what about the why? Why is this happening?
I can't begin to speculate about this. We haven't done the science. Nobody has really looked at it on a global basis systematically. We've started to do that, and there are a number of groups that are working towards that. There are a number of scientists who are certainly willing to spend time on it. As you may know, there is a new project in France now that is staffed to look at new cases and also working on statistics on their old cases. That's the kind of thing that should be done, and there should be an exchange of data. Also, I do believe that the government, the U.S. government, has lots of data. I don't know whether they have hardware. Some of my friends are convinced that there is hardware.
They do, yeah.
There is certainly material. I have, as I mentioned, I have strange metal. I've reported on that in confrontations. There are a number of samples around that can be tested. The government has a lot of data that it has not made available to scientists. And by now, isn't it about time that material be made available?
Have you ever tested any of the material that you have?
Yes. Yes.
And well,
essentially, what I found was two different classes of things. One class is very light, silvery metal, very often aluminum allied with other things. Again, nothing that would be unknown to an earth chemist. Dr. Sturrock at Stanford has analyzed some samples of magnesium that appeared under very very strange conditions, again in Brazil, and he looked for isotopes, unusual isotope ratios. To my knowledge, again, this is not something that would be extraterrestrial by its nature. The other type of material is simply looks like slag. And it has been reported in several cases. I have samples of a case like that in Council Bluffs, where an object was seen by 11 people. The police was on the site of the... There was a large deposit of melted metal. The police were there. They took pictures of the metal glowing in melted state. This was at night in a park in Council Bluffs. That has never been explained. There was no way of getting that mass of melted of molten metal there at that time. There was an object in the sky that is similar to other cases we have. The material was tested, and it was essentially indistinguishable from slag.
First-time caller line. Dennis, you're on the air with us. Hi there.
Hey, hello, George. Dr. Vallee, great honor to be calling into the show. A question for Dr. Vallee.
Sure.
I have read all of your books, sir, and I seem to remember you'd indicated the phenomenon had changed, had been evolving over time. That was a salient theme in your books. And I was wondering if you might comment on whether you felt that, for example, now we're seeing more triangular-shaped craft versus maybe 50 years ago there was traditional discs with domes on top. I was wondering if you might comment on whether or not that metamorphosis was something caused by the phenomenon itself or something in our consciousness that is interpreting the phenomenon.
Great question.
It's a great question, and it's very hard to theorize about this. Of course, Jung, the psychologist, in his theory of the collective unconscious, has suggested that UFOs were an expression of the collective unconscious, and that would explain why the appearance of the phenomenon would seem to adapt to the culture in which it was perceived. In 1897, people were seeing cigar-shaped airships over America, then it morphed into something that seemed to follow the culture of the time, and at one time it did look like spacecraft, and now it looks like either advanced probes or triangles and so on. I don't know whether that's just our projection of what we expect it to look like. Remember that if you really want to go back, you go back to Ezekiel in the Bible talking about a flying chariot. Well, what he describes has nothing to do with a chariot, but that was the word that he had available to describe something that moved and that seemed to have wheels. And so it's very difficult to peel out the linguistic layer and the perception layer from, and get back to the actual phenomenon. In fact, in the field, I've trained myself to try to ask questions of witnesses in many different ways to try to elicit almost getting into a very quiet state with them where they can peel out these layers and begin to get to the deeper layers of description of what they've seen, and that's how you can get to a better description.
Are you working on another book, Jacques?
No, sir. I think I'm done from now. I've written a novel that was published in France last year, and I'm making it available in English through Amazon now. It's called Stratagem. And, you can say things in fiction that you can't say as a scientist in nonfiction. So I'm having fun with that, but I don't plan to write anything more on the subject.
All right, and what's the name of it again?
Stratagem.
Stratagem. Okay, how do you spell that?
Stratagem.
Stratagem.
Okay. Stratagem is the ruse of war.
Okay, very good. West of the Rockies, you're on with Jacques Vallee. Hi there.
Yes, hi there. Good evening, Mr. Noori. Dr. Vallee, your name and your books were household words and objects as I was growing up, so this is quite a delight.
Thank you.
And you're welcome. And my question, this is, I'm going to try to frame it as succinctly as I can. It's an intriguing postulation that is not my own, but it has to do with experiencers' descriptions of the large eyes, the absence of mouths, and the bright lights. And someone, at a time that I just absolutely cannot give you a source for this, I just don't remember, mentioned the comparison to the birthing styles. Before we had Lamaze and Bradley and soft lights, in other words, the bright light of perhaps an approaching craft being the surgical light, the attendants, the doctor, the nurses with masks, which would prevent their mouths from showing, which would translate to the absence of mouth. And the large eyes. In other words, in later memory as an adult, perhaps, a confusion, a memory without proper comprehension. Have you ever heard of this? And I would be fascinated to get your take on it.
Yes, I have heard of that. It's possible that One thing we do know about UFOs, and I think everybody agrees, it's a close encounter is a traumatic experience.
Yes.
So the question is, can we trust the witnesses? When the witnesses give us a description, are they describing what was actually there, or are they describing an impression that was implanted in their mind, or something that psychologically they regressed to spontaneously under the terror or under the pressure or the trauma of being close to that object? So there are people who are, you know, open-minded skeptics who say, look, you know, if these people have been exposed to, for example, a very powerful electromagnetic field of some sort, maybe even a natural one, that could have caused them to have hallucinations, and under those hallucinations, they might regress to, you know, to a childhood memory, or they might regress to a screen memory, and they might see something like that. So yes, I've seen, and it's a very interesting parallel.
Yes.
Also, the description of the, of course, the short grays almost look like fetuses.
That's fascinating. I hadn't thought of that.
And, you know, there are many similarities like that that would be, you know, a delight for a psychiatrist also. For example, when you talk to people who describe being inside a UFO, you quickly come to the realization that the inside is bigger than the outside. Well, the one, of course, object that we know in our experience where the inside is bigger than the outside is a womb. And, you know, the experience of abduction has many similarities with the experience of birth. But it's also, you know, a similarity with the experience of some initiation rituals, out-of-body experiences. So I think we would have to take all of that together, and I'm certainly not trained, you know, you would need anthropologists, you'd need people trained in mythology, people trained in psychiatry, to put all that together and to really map it into the body of data that the abductees are giving us.
Jacques, we're out of time, but I want to thank you, and of course you are invited here, my friend, anytime you want, okay?
Thank you very much, and, you know, thanks for the people who called. They've been very patient and, you know, great questions.
Jacques Vallee. The study of UFOs, you've got to include Dr. Jacques Vallee. I'll be back in a moment. Floating format tonight. Stephen Bassett comes in as we continue to talk about the government imposing this embargo of truth on UFOs. Well, as we continue our UFO extravaganza and our floating format, Stephen Bassett comes in next. He heads up the Paradigm Research Group. He's putting on the X Conference in Washington, D.C. I'll be out there with him in April. Back in a moment on Coast to Coast AM. Stephen Bassett, leading advocate for ending the 60-year government-imposed truth embargo regarding the extraterrestrial presence in the human race. He is a political activist. He's a lobbyist. He's a commentator, founder of the Paradigm Research Group, and the executive director of the Extraterrestrial Phenomena Political Action Committee. And he is also the executive producer of the X Conference, which takes place out there on the East Coast in April. Stephen Bassett with us for 2 hours. Hey, Stephen, how are you?
I'm fine, George. It's great to be with you again.
Likewise, likewise. Lots been going on in the UFO community these days, huh?
Absolutely.
Stephenville, Texas, what's your take on that one?
Well, you discussed it a little bit earlier today, and I know you've had people on the show previously talking about it. What's important about it from my perspective is, first and foremost, the amount of media coverage it's getting and the overall amount of media coverage on the UFO issue in general that we're seeing, it is dramatically increased over the last 2 years. The threshold by which the editors and reporters and whatever will now go after these stories has substantially been lowered. This is a sea change in media coverage, which has very significant implications for the disclosure process. Stephenville is an example of this. There was also another significant sighting in San Diego. It got some coverage for a while, but then that faded away. The Stephenville case got outstanding coverage for two primary reasons. One, The event occurred near the Crawford Ranch, President Bush's home in Texas, and jets were scrambled. Anytime jets are scrambled, that's very significant. A similar thing happened in July of 2002, right in the middle of my congressional campaign at the time, of all things, near Washington, D.C., where a blue, a UFO blue orb, large, was seen, extraordinary maneuvers, and it being, you know, post-911 and being in the Washington area, they had to scramble the jet. Well, by doing that, that made it a story. The second thing that's important about the Stephenville sighting is, once again, it's very revealing. The government's sort of Pavlovian reaction, very defensive, denied that any jets
were out there. Deny, yeah. Isn't it?
And then when they realize, wait a minute, it's impossible to not know it F-16 when it flies over, or several of them, and there's a lot of people that saw it, and this isn't going to hold up. And so after a while, they reversed and said, yes, there were training jets there. What that means is they scrambled jets to go after this thing, which obviously they had to do because it was near the Crawford White House. So that was revealing. And then the third thing that's very significant about it is that the reporter that did the primary coverage of this for their local paper, the Empire Tribune, and did great stuff. I mean, wrote wonderful articles, front page stuff, which helped to generate enormous publicity for Stephenville and what have you, left the paper just recently, and that was significant. So he sort of had in this sighting an encapsulation of, you know, the whole last 60 years, right? In one thing, right, all in a big ball. So it's very educational to pick it apart. But, you know, George, I'll tell you, the one thing that distresses me the most, and something maybe somebody has not said on your show before. Look, I was raised in a military family, and I consider myself a pretty good citizen, and I'm not a raving nationalist, but I mean, I have great feelings for the United States. I have feelings for my country. It's an amazing place. It's allowed me to do a lot of wonderful things. And one of the reasons we are that way is because we have a military that's been extraordinarily loyal and patriotic, and we've just had no difficulties with it with respect to supporting the Constitution and maintaining our way of life. And the abuse that the military has taken at the hands of politicians, and particularly because of policies emanating out of what I call the secret empire, has been awful. And so when you have the military having to make these kinds of confabulations, saying, oh, no, we didn't have jets out there, and then having, oh, yes, we had jets out there, and then putting poor Colonel Haynes in front of the press in 1997 at the Pentagon, stating, okay, now look, this, it's the Mogul balloon thing, and the test dummies, mm-hmm. you know, were dropped, and the film of that actually shows the press saying, Colonel, those test dummies, weren't they dropped much later in the 50s? And he says, well, yes, but you know, there's time compression and people get confused.
Yeah, yeah.
You saw an alien body, you're going to forget what year you saw that. This is embarrassing to the military. It's demeaning. It's degrading. It puts them in a terrible position. It undermines trust in the military and the part of the people. It's just one more reason why this truth embargo is simply no longer viable, no longer acceptable, and has to end.
Well, you know, Stephen, you have especially been pounding away at this for years. I mean, I remember when I first started talking to you in 97, out of the place in St. Louis, KTRS, our mm-hmm. affiliate there. You've been pushing this disclosure for well over 10 years now. You've devoted your life to it.
Well, I devoted the rest of it, the rest of my life to it.
What's left, yeah.
Yeah, whatever there is left. But, you know, George, I was on your show before I ever did Coast to Coast, right, in St. Louis. I mean, you were supportive
That's
of
true.
This
yeah,
work,
that's true.
And you were looking ahead already to the political aspects of this and to the fact that it's going to take more than science to get this thing moved forward. And here we are 11 years later, it's not there.
I think arts producers heard you on my show because they were listening to me, unbeknownst to me at the time, and they heard you.
Very possible.
Yeah,
very
that's
possible.
How that
of course,
started.
Art major figure in the information flow that has helped the disclosure process and movement in general to grow. All right, he allowed it in. You've obviously kept it going. It's not all there is, but it is extremely critical. This is going to require political resolution. A lot of science was done. It was done as well as it could be with no money, since the government didn't provide any, the schools didn't provide any, the foundations didn't provide any. You had all these citizen scientists out there kind of doing the best they could, and they did pretty well, all things considered. But as McDonald found out near the end of his life, you could do all the finest science you could. The government was not going in the truth embargo. It wasn't about science. It was about maintaining a national security secret and embargoing this issue until such time as the government felt it was appropriate for us to know at least the fundamentals, namely there's an ET presence. And it really helped break him and helped lead to his suicide. Well, it's been many years now. And the point is that the issue is not science, meaning that the presence of ETs is not really a science thing. What their craft is made of, yeah, that's sciencey, and their biology, and